Marcy Chode. It's MRC Chode to see a resident jaw. Not old jaw, no healthy Cassie. It's MRC to see a resident A.
Oh, you jaw.
Then no health LTC jaw. 390, no need on LTC. That's MRC to see a resident. So, I'm going to now say it in English because I do have a point here.
Thank you, ma'am.
What I just finished saying is thank you in coming to my territory to talk about this important issue. But I also thank everybody here for coming and talking about this because it is important, especially when you're making new laws, and we're still dealing with old laws that I don't agree with as a Dene, especially when you make laws in my territory, okay, that don't coincide with my spirituality, my religious beliefs, my practices, and my traditions. And I think Mr. McLeod knows that the Dene have had plans from time immemorial. We had our medicines. And that these kind of laws take away from the Dene. Why? Because we're put in mainstream. An example, the language here in Canada, because Canada was incorporated under the United States, it couldn't recognize the tribal people's languages in Canada and the US. So in Canada, they claim French and English as their first and second language, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So what do you propose? What is the federal government and all the committees and the people in Canada propose to do to help all the tribal people across Canada, not just the Dene up here, but all tribes? Because the one thing that I do know, because I have been in this arena before, is that a lot of the information that is being sent to the communities or to educate the communities are all done in French and English, majority. Okay? For example, when you get on the plane, you don't hear any Dene safety translation, so that's something too I've been talking about for quite a while and ignored. So I just feel that this is another process where the people, the Dene people, are going to be ignored. Because when you look at it, there's about 42,000 people living in the Northwest Territories. How many are Dene? When I was Dene National Chief, I had responsibility for 21,000 Dene. That's not including the Métis or others that moved here. So you take that. So what are you left with? Rest of the population. How many come up here to work for the government? So what is happening, what I see here in the Northwest Territories, is the government people coming up here, making regulations, working, and voting on laws that really do not apply to the Dene people. And I say this, I don't say this lightly, I say this because I did my homework. I have to, because I have to come to these forums to protect the people's rights, the language. So when you say the Canadian law, I'm Dene. And that's the one thing that I do understand. There is Dene law still in my language. There is Dene law before Canadian law. Dene people had plants. A few years back, I had a great uncle that grew this plant. One day, he revealed that to me. And I said to him, "Uncle, what are you doing growing it? You know, if the police found out, or anybody found out, you can go to jail." He says, why would they put me in jail for growing my medicine? Because this is what this Canadian law has done to our people. You want to regulate this cannabis, but yet there's no regulation on alcohol. And I have buried many of my family members with alcohol-related deaths. You talk about protecting our kids and keeping them safe. Our kids up north are not safe. I don't feel they are, because we still have a lot of issues, unresolved issues. Child welfare. You guys haven't even dealt with it 60s and 70s scoop. And you talk about our health. The Dene funding is just ridiculous when it comes to our health in our small communities. We can't compete with Yellowknife. That's another area that I'm burying a lot of my relatives. I don't see any of these people coming to our communities and helping to bury our relatives. They're only up here for a short period. And this is nothing against people. But there are times when the truth has to be spoken. And I am no longer afraid to speak the truth. Because today I am a grandmother. The government did a lot of damage up here. The people that came up here without realizing did a lot of damage. So I see that, you know, with this regulating and laws, and what I do know is that how did the territorial government and the federal government get jurisdiction outside the 10 kilometers? You know? So does this apply to the Dene? Outside the 10 kilometer jurisdiction, for example? Because I was told, and I learned, that even in 1897, the Honorable J.J. Coram, Solicitor General for the Queen, stated that they could not deal with the Indian states' bylaws, but rather international laws. But yet, this territorial government and this federal government has been regulating and charging us under these types of laws and restricting and regulating to the point where we can't even hunt our foods. You know, so yeah, it's going to be very interesting because, you know, I could go on and ask more questions, but I know there are other people here. But I think my point is, because I am filing, and actually I have filed a $63 trillion lien against the federal government, against the territorial government, and against a lot of organizations in the Northwest Territories. And yeah, it was circulated. Leaders laughed at it. They thought it was a joke. It's not a joke to me. Because of these kinds of regulations. And what has transpired to the Dene people over the last 150 years? When the first ship came over, it was for trade, not to put us on reserves and to regulate us under the law. Because you know, as a police officer, you know, when you apply laws, you know, there's no color, there's no whatever, depending where you are. But I think I've said enough. But I want to point out those things, that the language, okay, jurisdiction, and you know, how this territorial government will allow Yellowknife, for example, to have how many liquor stores, and regulate into other communities. Now, the other communities, how are they going to be looked after? Like the other fellow said, You know, how are you going to deal with the other communities? Because the language is a barrier. We know that from all the other programs the territorial government and the federal government are decking out, for me, is a big failure. So this is another process that I see that can be another one if we don't ensure that the interest, when you talk about the territories, remember that Dene people outnumber the residents up here that moved here for jobs or to start a business, because this is basically the crowd that we're dealing with. I don't see any Dene people around. And we're supposed to apply laws. You know, where is the process for the Dene people? I believe they should have a say, not just Yellowknife, Hay River, but the smaller communities. Because believe it or not, a lot of the smaller communities, a lot of the older people do use. Because remember, residential school. We're still dealing with post-traumatic stress disorder that this territorial government, federal government, will not look at. But the other day they had PTSD for something else, but they totally didn't look at the PTSD for residential school. So we have a lot of people that are affected up here that could use that marijuana. But again, if this law isn't looked at properly and not, you know, the people not consulted, you know, I see everybody else having control over it but the Dene. Because remember, this is our territory. We did open our doors. We did invite people to come and we made a, there is a bargain sent over by Queen Victoria. I would like Michael McLeod to take a look at the Queen's bargain, because that applies to your position.
Yeah, thank you, Noeline.
Thank you.
Very, lots of good points, and I have looked at the bargain. And the government's aware that there's so much work to do when it comes to Indigenous people, and that's the reason we've put together a ministerial committee to look at all legislation, look at all policies that impact and affect Aboriginal Indigenous people. And they've been working hard at it, and I think we'll start to see some results maybe by spring. And we've established a number of tables to talk about the very issues that you've raised: language, education, health. And four tables have been set up, one for the First Nations, one for the Métis, one for the Inuit, and one for the Land Claim Coalition groups. So there is discussion going on, and you're quite right. In the communities, when you start talking, I've traveled to every assembly this year, except for the Quechua, which is still yet to come. But when it comes to talking about marijuana or any type of drugs, the older people and the people in the communities lump everything together. There's no distinction between marijuana and cocaine and crack. It's all drugs, and there's all concerns. And a lot of our community are saying we need to do something to get a handle on it. We have situations where we have no RCMP in the community, we have lots of drugs coming in, we have lots of alcohol coming in, and those are very concerning. And whose responsibility is it? Who gets called out when there's a crisis? It's the chief. And I have talked to chiefs right across the territories where they've had people that have under the influence of alcohol or some hard drugs, where they've had guns, knives pointed at them. So it's a huge issue, and it needs support, you know. And again, the health system, we need a lot of work in that area. Post-traumatic stress is a crisis. Probably every second person that has an addiction, if you scratch below the surface, you'll find that there's trauma or post-traumatic stress. We have a suicide every 14 days in Northwest Territories, and most of them are Aboriginal youth. And those are indicators of the situation that our society's in. So we have a lot of work to do, and we have a lot of work to do with Aboriginal people. And we're working hard to make sure that Aboriginal people are standing there as equal partners, as nation to nation. And some of that has started already, and I think we're going to see a lot of progress in the next while. Progress that we never seen for a good dozen years, and I think those doors are opening. The talks have begun. We have entered into negotiations or discussions with every Aboriginal government that has filed a claim or that is wanting to improve the situation that they're in. There's 10 sets of talks going on right now right across the territories, and we virtually had none up to a couple of years ago. So I think we're making good headway. But you're right, we have such a long ways to go to start building healthy communities and healthy individuals.
I just may add, I have listened very carefully to the comments you made, particularly around language. And when we talk about making sure that information is available to young people to make better, healthier choices, I will take back the message that you shared with us about the importance of making sure that that's available in a culturally appropriate language that the young people will understand, and we will see if we can address that particular concern, because I want that information available to all young people.
Okay, there's a question.
Yeah, just a question and a comment. Well, I'm glad to see that this is being regulated and it's being legalized. Anything that is prohibited tends to go underground, and it leads to crime and more debts associated with violence, as well as exploitation. One of the questions, one of the comments I also wanted to stress on was the plowing of any of the revenue back into education and health. As the lady pointed out, especially in the Northwest Territories, there's no center for mental health and addiction. We tend to treat people down south in Edmonton, for example, and they return back to their communities where there is little or no support. And this is something that applies not just to cannabis, but also to alcohol and the post-traumatic stress of its peoples. So with respect to the Northwest Territories, the expectation is that the government, both the federal and territorial government, will make a concerted effort to focus on mental health and addiction as part of their plowing of that revenue back into the communities, particularly here in the north, where we're isolated in some cases, there's no road access, and the enforcement is sparse in some communities when it comes to enforcing the laws. There was one item in here that I read, and it's similar to that comment that was made about 100 centimeters height. Who's going to enforce whether you have four plants or a rainforest in your basement, for example? At the end of the day, you, especially in our remote communities, especially for people who use it medicinally or for people for recreational use, for example, that will be difficult to enforce. Four plants, it's similar to the 100 centimeters high statement that was made. And the other concern is the fact that, as the gentleman said before, you've got these plants that are now growing in your house, and your kids now have access to it. And especially in a remote community, there's no one to enforce that. The municipal enforcement have a hard time enforcing people's dogs pooping on the sidewalk versus regulating marijuana grow-ups in your house. So it's a unique environment, and I know that the territorial government will have a role to play in that as well, but it's something that is of concern because I know for a fact that there are kids in grade 7 that are smoking illegal marijuana currently today.
You know, I have to tell you, yes, as a cop, and I used to be a cop. For about 40 years, I was a cop. Enforcing these regulations is going to be a huge challenge. I spent 2 hours today at the RCMP detachment, and they're asking exactly the same questions every police officer and every police chief I've spoken to across the country are asking: how do we enforce this? We talked about, like, my preference, I would have no personal cultivation. I would not, because as a cop, that's a very difficult thing to manage. But we also respect that, people we let people make beer in their home. We let them make wine. We just don't let them go to the end of the driveway and sell it to their neighbors. And most of them discover after they've made beer and wine that it's not worth the trouble. That's what, you know, you give the wine to your neighbors. Most of them really don't appreciate it, by the way. And it's not worth the trouble. But do we want to criminalize those who choose to do it for themselves? You know, you talk about how do you restrict the access that a child might have to that in the home. I would say the same thing about alcohol. For a parent to bring alcohol into the home, most young people, when you talk about where they got alcohol from, they stole it from their father's liquor cabinet. And so there is a parental responsibility here to exercise some control over, if you're bringing any kind of a risky substance into the house, to keep it away from your children. And it is not just a matter of law enforcement. We don't want to try to manage everything with the criminal law, because we don't want to criminalize our citizens. We want to help our citizens be healthy and safe and make better choices and help protect our kids and keep our communities in a livable place. We want people to make socially responsible choices so that they're not driving their neighbors crazy and putting others' health or quality of life at risk. And so it's a line we have to draw with regulation to say there is a limit beyond which you are not conducting yourself properly. And so we set a limit. I think 4 plants is a reasonable limit. I think the 100 centimeter thing was just unreasonable because it was unmanageable. But we wanted to place reasonable limits on people's conduct, mostly because we want to protect against people, criminals using that as an opportunity to have 100 plants in the basement and to sell it out in the schoolyard. That's what we want to prevent. And so the rules are put in place to prevent that from happening. But to a large extent, we also have to rely on parents and people to make responsible choices. And we don't want to criminalize them for those choices. We just want to encourage them to do the right thing.
John?
Yeah. I'm glad you have said, excuse me, parents have a role. And I haven't heard that. Parents have a role in today just for cigarettes, not to smoke around the infants and the small children. They will have the same responsibility as parents, not to smoke marijuana with their kids sitting beside them and things of that nature. Equally so, not to be drinking and you know, leaving it a half a glass on the table for the kids to pick it up. But we have to work with parents who have some of them have parenting skills or lack of. And my concern is that the education must be in the school, but we also have to work very closely with the education of adults and how to look at and deal with the issue of not only alcohol, but other drugs in the family, in the home.
Yeah.
And that is something I think that we have failed miserably with alcohol, because the kids have suffered the consequences of alcohol in the families.
Yeah,
so I hope we don't make that mistake with cannabis.
And we're trying to learn from the mistakes we've made in the past in other substances, but we're also trying to learn from some of the things that have been useful in those experiences as well. And you know, I always say, if you want to educate young people, young people get their information from their peers, from their parents, and their teachers. And so we've got to make sure their peers, their parents, and their teachers have good information. And the more facts we can put into this discussion and take away some of the myths and some of the fear-mongering, but an honest discussion about this. And I've talked to doctors and teachers across the country about this as well. And one of the things they've said is it's very difficult to talk to a young person about choices, healthier, safer choices, for a prohibited substance. You can't talk to a young person about making healthier choices when something's just against the law. But if we remove the prohibition and regulate it, then those conversations are possible. And I think we can do a better job. I hope we can do a better job. But I will tell you, as a police chief, I always talked about public safety as a shared responsibility. You can't just leave it to the enforcers. You can't just leave it to the cops. You can't just leave it to the teachers or the doctors or to governments. The safety of our children, the safety of our communities, the livability of our neighborhoods is a responsibility we all share. We all have a role to play in that. Some of us play different roles in that, but we all have that responsibility. And I always find it difficult when you go into a community and say, well, you haven't done this or they didn't do that. We all have to sort of pick it up and do better. And I think there's a consensus everywhere I've gone, because people recognize we can do this better. And so we're trying to make sure we put the tools in place, the resources and the tools and the education materials and reasonable, thoughtful regulations so that we can do better.
Thank you. So I've been trying to come up with a question, but I think I have more comments than questions. Canada has now got a 109-year history of a social experiment in prohibition. 109 years of failure in prohibition. But we keep trying it. So I'm glad to know that things are moving forward to reduce prohibition, because we have failed at it for 109 years now. I have, for the past 36 years, worked in the field of disabilities, and in the past 12 years, I've worked in restorative justice, 13 years of restorative justice, and working with the street-involved population and the youth. Youth do not get any information about drugs from their parents. They get their information from youth, as they do about sex or anything else. Youth get their information from each other. The parents are not giving the information. The schools bring in the RCMP to do the DARE program or other guest speakers, but the kids who need that information are outside behind the school smoking dope, and the kids who don't need the information are sitting there going, why are you telling me this? So we have really missed the mark on educating youth about what's going on in their choices. Legalizing marijuana to regulate it, I remember hearing a study several years ago from Nunavut that in a survey done, 10% of the 6 to 10 year old children admitted smoking. 6 to 10 years old are smoking. So we're not really regulating cigarettes or alcohol, and so regulating marijuana will probably be about the same. So while enforcement is a key part of looking after this, the educational component that we continue to fail because we're trying to educate the parents how to educate their children, or the treatment of all the traumas and stressors, the number of people that I know through my career who smoke marijuana to sleep at night because their anxiety bothers them. And so how we're not teaching people about meditation and self-care and how exercise can help with our sleep patterns. People are turning to marijuana to be able to sleep. And the Schizophrenia Association of Canada did a very wide medical study for many years to see if marijuana use in teenagers was connected to schizophrenia. What they found was it's connected to schizophrenia and many other mental disorders. So that's been confirmed, the research exists. And so what are we doing for the mental health and well-being of young people when here in Yellowknife, I've met children who in grade 8 are suspended from school for bringing marijuana to school? If a kid brings marijuana to school, how good is their home environment? Why are you suspending this kid? So what are we doing to support the very young people who are turning to it? And how are we going to, so I'm glad that you're the Parliamentary Secretary for Justice and Health, because this is a health crisis in this country that is being taken care of by the justice system that is very ill-equipped to deal with this. So we need to put those health supports in place urgently, because we don't want our children turning to drugs or and alcohol to support the stuff that they just can't pack anymore. It's too heavy for them. The witnessing violence in the home, being abused or neglected, all of that, you know, all of what they're packing is too heavy, and they turn to self-medication because there's no other alternatives. So while this might be under the realm of justice, I hope that health is really taking it seriously. And please speak to your friends in public safety about moving that pardon system along, because, totally aside now, but the people that I've encountered needing help are getting ripped off by those criminal organizations like Pardons Canada and other organizations that are charging thousands of dollars and not getting a person anywhere. And it's not only the financial burden today, it's the narrative burden that people have to explain everything that they've done in their past. And I've met mostly immigrants or others who don't have English as a first language, or people who have one conviction for impaired driving 25 years ago, or one conviction for possession from 30 years ago, and that's still impeding their progress in their life. So that's aside from tonight, but you have friends in public safety that you can talk to. And I think I covered the points I wanted to make, so thank you for listening.
Of course, thank you for sharing your experience. And I've also spent a lot of years dealing with street-involved youth. I was on the board at Covenant House in Toronto for almost a decade. I will tell you just a little bit from my own experience, though. A lot of parents are having conversations with their young people about their health and about their safety and about drug use. And I know lots of parents that are very good at that. And a lot of young people get their first information there. When I talked to you earlier, where like kids, their number one source is their peers. But parents and teachers also have a role. And you know, there are other important people in their lives, too. And if they're street involved, it might be a youth worker on the street. But there are people that they respect and whose advice they take. And so we want to make sure that they all get good information to do that. And so we're all committed to that. I also wanted to sort of reemphasize, if I wasn't clear on this before, I think what's unique about the Canadian approach to cannabis legalization and regulation, it's based entirely on a public health framework. We began with a study by Center of Addiction and Mental Health. They wrote a paper on a public health framework for cannabis regulation that really, for me, that was the most informative document that I'd read prior to getting involved in the government on this thing. Our task force was sent out to look at all of the health and social harms related to this and how to reduce them. That's a public health approach. And so this isn't about criminal justice. Even when the Prime Minister gave me this job, he had me do this for three ministers. I work for the Minister of Justice, the Minister of Health, and the Minister of Public Safety. And so all three had a role to play in this. And I will tell you that the regulations that have been developed were developed through the Health Ministry. And it was in recognition of that approach of reducing harm, not just to the individual, but to communities, that has been the focus of all of this work. And you know, since 1922, cannabis has been a prohibited substance, and that law is no longer being very effective. And one of the reasons it's not effective, the existing criminal law, is the police, the prosecutors, and the courts don't want to swing that sledgehammer to deal with a kid who's now using cannabis. We'd much prefer that kid not be buying and using cannabis because it's risky for them, but we don't want to lock them up for it. We don't want to lock up our citizens for this. And so that's why a regulatory approach, public education and a public health framework is what we're trying to achieve. And so the things that you've shared with from your perspective on what you would like to see the government to do, that's the path we're going. Now, not precisely as you've described it, quite frankly, because we have a number of different issues we have to address, but it's very much a public health approach to this. And frankly, the Prime Minister's also asked me to look into the government's response to the opioid crisis, which is actually killing people in this country, and close to 3,000 people in Canada will lose their life to this terrible tragedy, which is the opioid crisis, which is killing so many of our people, to try to bring not a legalization regulation approach, but that public health approach to reduce the harms, all of the harms that are associated to that opioid crisis, to see if we can save some lives. And so we're working on that as well. And it's one of the reasons I now am also working for the Minister of Health as well as the Minister of Justice, is to bring that focus, because, you know, we believe that governments can do some things that will save lives. Society has to do some things. That's that shared responsibility I spoke of. We all have a role to play in this. And so if we all focus on the right things, we can achieve the right things. But it has to be, and it's one of the reasons I when Michael asked me to come here, I was grateful for the opportunity to come, because I have a pretty good understanding of how people see things in Toronto. I don't understand the challenges that you've shared with us, and I need to come and listen. And I'm grateful for the I'm very sincerely grateful for the opportunity to come and listen to things that I do not understand, and to learn from that, and to take that back, and to share what I've learned with those of us who have responsibility for responding to these things, but also to acknowledge I cannot understand all of the things you've shared with us by listening to you only for a few minutes. And it's part of an ongoing dialogue, a discussion, a nation-to-nation discussion that has to take place and must continue to take place. But I want to assure you all that we're trying to be respectful of all of the different communities and parts of this vast country, and to learn from your experience and to apply your experience to what we're trying to do. And also, a lot of people have asked me, you know, why doesn't the federal government just say this is how it will all be done? Why are you leaving this responsibility to the provinces and territories? And some of the provinces and territories, you know, said you're giving us all this work, and it's a lot of work, by the way. It's a great deal we've asked of them. And they have other priorities, but we've asked them to take on this work as well. And they say, why are you doing that? And it's because I think it's so important that how that system actually operates in your community be appropriate to this community. And so your elected representatives have much more, you know, Michael has an influence of what he and I do in Ottawa for this community, but your territorial government and band councils and chiefs all will have say in how it should actually be applied here. Mm-hmm. So that's and I'm very grateful for the opportunity to come and hear all these different perspectives.
Thank you.
So I just wanted to bring this back to the parental responsibility.
Yep.
I'll just give you a little bit of backstory about myself. I have an 8-year-old at home. I don't want to explain to my 8-year-old what a pot plant is. Not quite yet. She just learned how to not blow up stuff in the microwave.
That was an important life lesson. I'm glad she learned.
I also have 2 dogs at home.
Yep.
They pee on everything. Don't want my dogs peeing on my pot plant. If I already have my ACFPR license,
yep,
and I'm a licensed producer already, is it plausible for community support, for education, is it plausible that I open up a community garden where everybody can go and grow together?
I don't have an easy answer for that, but I can tell you under the ACMPR licenses, the license that you say you already have, there is an authority, it's a limited authority, for a designated grower. And so there is, forgive me if I don't get this precisely right, because I haven't been involved in the development of those regulations. I've been dealing with the other set, but I have some understanding of them. But I understand that whatever number of plants are authorized under your medical authorization for the growing of plants,
yeah,
then one individual can do that as a designated grower for up to 4 individuals. It's either 2 or 4, and I can't recall precisely, and you'll forgive me. So there is a possibility of having very limited designated growing for others. But with respect to a garden, I don't know. I honestly don't know. I'll try to find out. But it's under those medical regulations, which are pretty complex in themselves. One of the things that, you know, as I've traveled across the country, a lot of people's negative experience with illegal grow operations are tied to their experience with those who just were playing with the rules a little bit on the medical side. And so making sure that we do that right, in a way which is responds to people's needs, but it's done in a way that is socially responsible and doesn't interfere with other people's right to their quality of life and their safety in their communities. And so we just have to make sure that we put good regulations in place that are enforceable, that people will understand and respect and follow, so that we can uphold your right to have access to what you require medically, but do it in a way which is respectful of everyone else in your community's right not to be interfered with by that activity. And so that's one of the purposes of regulation, is to find where that fine balance is, to respect your rights to do what you require, either medically or even as an adult, to make choices for yourself, but not to do it in a way which interferes with other people's choices not to do it.
I'm not saying only do a community. I'm saying, can we do both? If we did have a community garden, we could have optimal security because it would already be in place. We could have experienced growers teaching everybody how to do it properly, i.e. not to do the 100 centimeters. And we could also get it out of the hands of our young people, because we talk about responsibility towards our youth.
And if you're doing it communally,
yeah,
it's also possible to apply for a license from Health Canada to produce and you know, in a certain controlled way, so that what is being produced is of known potency and purity, so that we protect the health of our citizens, and that it could be produced. Like, part of what you're describing sounds to me a little bit like this notion of a craft grower. Not unlike, you know, you're probably familiar with craft breweries. So that's, you know, smaller breweries where for a small, you know, business, they have these things, but they have certain regulatory requirements that they have to meet. And so they obtain a license to operate a craft brewery or a boutique winery. That they have some of those in the country as well. I think it's possible under the Health Canada regulations for licensed producers, for a smaller producer, and by the way, most of them are. There's some 61 licenses been approved. Most of them have fewer than 100 employees, so they would be identified as a small business, but they don't require 100 employees. But as long as they're willing and able to meet the regulatory requirements for security, sanitation, safety, to warrant the purity and submit to the testing and oversight that exists for all of the licensed producers, it would be possible, I think, for a cooperative group to obtain a license, as long as they're willing to abide by the regulatory requirements of that license.
The license that you speak of, like the ACMPR license?
No, that's a different thing. The ACMPR licenses are authorizations and limited license under the medical marijuana regime. I'm talking about the non-medical. So if you're producing for non-medical purposes, recreational,
yeah,
adult use, then you'd have to produce it under the regulations for that. Which would require a different license, also from Health Canada, but a different license. I apologize that's complicated, and apologize to everybody else that I'm doing such a lousy job probably of explaining it. Yeah, well, that's, you know what, and I have to tell you, that's kind of the nature of regulations. Sorry about that. Like, before, the criminal law was basically on one piece of paper, you do it, we'll lock you up. And now when you talk about regulations, you're talking about hundreds of pieces of paper and a great deal more complexity, but it's important. Those regulations actually mean something. We're not making regulations for the sake of creating red tape and being annoying. We're doing it in order to reduce those harms we've talked about and to protect people.
Yeah, I just want to make two points here. When you talk about health and mental health and treatment, one of the things that has taken place here in the Northwest Territories for the last few years is the shutdown of all of our treatment centers. So, you know, that's like, I don't know, you know, we have all kinds of addictions, we have all kinds of issues, but yet the one thing that could make a difference in the Dene life has been taken away. So, Michael, what do you propose to reverse this? No treatment centers in the Northwest Territories. Why is that? You know, and here everyone talks about mental health and, you know, all these issues, but yet there is nothing to support the people.
Is that something that we can use our taxes on?
Well, there is...
Just let me finish.
Okay, but you, I thought you were asking...
So, no, she jumped in. So, how do you propose to regulate if there are no treatment centers in the north? Michael?
A couple of things. There is treatment in the north, but most of it is on land at this point. It's mobility treatment that's being provided to the communities, for the communities. A lot of communities are taking part in it. And there is, the territorial government does provide resources to treat people in the south. And it's very costly, but it is happening, and a lot of people are taking advantage of it. Treatment centers is something that we should be looking at. We've talked about it. The Truth and Reconciliation recommendations actually talk about treatment for post-traumatic stress, for trauma, for all the things that we see as fallout from the residential school. I just was involved with the Indigenous committee that did a study on suicide. We also talked about the need for treatment centers. Now, that means it's going to require more resources. Those discussions need to happen with the territorial government. And at this point, the territorial government has been thinking about utilizing mobile centers or on land programs. And I think those discussions, as the resources become available, will escalate.
I see one solution to when you say there's no funding. I see the government as a middleman to the Dene people, where they outsource contracts and all of that stuff. So one recommendation is that, you know, you guys cut back on your salaries and all the benefits. We may be able to have treatment centers there then if we do that, because remember, the people that are coming up here to help us, okay? But how could they help us if there's nothing there? So that's my one point. And the other one is, when you talk about Canadian law, there was Dene law here. And one of the laws in our language was banishment. In English, it's called banishment. That if you've done something so detrimental to another human being or to your village, you were banished. Yet, I see a lot of these drug dealers bringing up fentanyl. Some of them my own relatives, by the way. Okay? My own relatives. Some of them as old as 70 years old, getting caught up. So, a lot of these drug dealers that are coming up from the south, they come up here, they live up here. What happens after they get out of jail? Nothing. They're allowed to roam free and pick up where they left off. I recommend that these big time drug dealers be banished from our communities and from the north. To go where? I don't know. But that was one Dene law. I think that should be applied back here in the north. Because all these people that are hurting the Dene by bringing in these drugs are taking our girls and prostituting them out as young as 12 and 13 years old. That is a crisis. Why do you think we have our young children as young as 10 years old commit suicide? Because there's no hope. There's hopelessness, helplessness in the communities. Our leaders are not doing anything because they're helpless, because they are regulated by the government. All they are, for me, are CEOs of a financial act. They're not leaders, per se, because they have no say in regulating Canadian law. Because we're deemed as civilians, not as Dene sovereign people, with our own Dene laws and way of life, traditions, practices, and beliefs. That's what we are up against.
Yes.
That's not taken into consideration when you're making these types of regulations and legislation and trying to turn things around. You still have to fix the past.
I agree. And those discussions are taking place. Many Aboriginal governments, Indigenous governments, have raised the issue of of treatment and the dealing with trauma. So when I talk about governments, I mean indigenous governments along with territorial government, you know, all have to be part of that. Cutting our wages, I certainly will bring that forward to see if there's a desire to do that.
There's no great desire to do that, I must confess.
Well, but hey, our workers in the community get less than what a Canadian government worker gets. They don't get the same benefit.
No, I understand that concern. Okay.
And the issue, the suicide point is a very important one. Suicide is a result of our youth and people in their communities that are feeling a real sense of despair, and they feel there's no way out of it. And we got to do everything we can to try to assist and change that mentality. You know, that may mean changing and creating more opportunities for people in the communities. It may mean simple things as providing more housing so we can cut back on the overcrowding. We have a real issue with sexual abuse in our communities, and a lot of people are saying those things have to be brought to the surface, and it's going to take a lot of investment. Language is being lost. Climate change is influencing our culture. There's so many things we can point to, but it's all going to take a collaborative approach. Like my discussions with the Prime Minister, he's indicated, how do we put a price tag on reviving some languages? How do we, if we were talking to the, for example, I'll use the Gwich'in. If we're talking about the Gwich'in language being deteriorated, How do we determine what it's going to cost to bring that back? That would be up to the Gwich'in to put a price tag on that, what it would cost, what initiatives have to be put in place.
Good
so there's
point.
There's a lot of work that has to be done, but it can't be done by just the government itself. It has to be done in a collaborative approach, and that's what's happening now. That's what we're moving to. We're moving towards working with Aboriginal governments as a nation and letting them decide how we find a solution moving forward on all these different fronts that you've taught.
So that's a good point, Michael, when you say, how do we put a price on it? I mean, no different than the federal government putting a price on the 60s and 70s school. $50,000, that's all I'm worth, $7 a day. Hey, you guys did it. Residential school, 60 school. So how could this be difficult? Or anything be difficult, the government has been putting a price because they are scared to go into a courtroom because they know they will have to pay out a lot more in tort law, right?
Good point.
Two questions. One is for you.